Good evening, everyone. On behalf of the faculty and in my own name, welcome to Notre Dame Seminary. For any guests who are here this evening, my name is Father Jim Wehner, and we're honored to have such a great, renowned speaker with us this evening. This is the Aquinas lecture. It's an annual lecture that we provide primarily to our seminarians and faculty, but open to the public. As you may or may not know, in the Code of Canon Law, the only saint besides Our Lady that's mentioned in the whole code is St. Thomas Aquinas. And the church puts before priestly formation St. Thomas as a pillar, both of philosophy and theology, the central figure of how our future priests are trained. And so it's great that Notre Dame Seminary is able to provide this annual lecture to stimulate our intellectual formation, which always points in the realm of priestly formation towards pastoral ministry. This evening to introduce and to MC our event is Father Philip Powell, who's the Director of Homiletics here at Notre Dame Seminary. He's gonna lead us in prayer, introduce our speaker, and so now we welcome our resident Jesuit, Father Powell.
That joke never gets old. Let's stand to pray, please. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. Creator of all things, true source of light and wisdom, lofty origin of all being, graciously let a ray of your brilliance penetrate into the darkness of our understanding, and take from us the double darkness in which we have been born, an obscurity of both sin and ignorance. Give us a sharp sense of understanding, a retentive memory, and the ability to grasp things correctly and fundamentally. Grant us the talent of being exact in our explanations and the ability to express ourselves with thoroughness and charm. Point out the beginning, direct the progress, and help in completion through Christ our Lord. Amen. And the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. I've been given the honor this evening of introducing our speaker. The decree on priestly training reads in part, in order that they may illumine the mysteries of salvation as completely as possible, the students, that is the seminarians, should learn to penetrate then more deeply with the help of speculation under the guidance of St. Thomas and to perceive their interconnections. Now, of course, Pope Leo XIII did as much as any pontiff to promote the study of the angelic doctor. In Aeternis Patris, he writes, with his spirit at once humble and swift, his memory ready and tenacious, his life spotless throughout, a lover of truth, for its own sake, richly endowed with human and divine science, like the sun, he heated the world with the warmth of his virtues and filled it with the splendor of his teaching. Pope Leo's words so beautifully express what anyone experiences when undertaking the serious study of St. Thomas's works. Now, the list of previous presenters for the Aquinas lecture is an impressive collection of scholars. Benedict Ashley, Brian Davies, Lawrence Dewan, John Whipple, Norris Clark, to name a few, but a veritable who's who of Thomistic scholars. This year, we have another notable scholar to add to our list, Father Stephen Brock. Father Brock has made important contributions in the area of Thomistic philosophy, especially in the area of metaphysics. He is currently professor of medieval philosophy and assistant dean of the Faculty of Philosophy at the Pontifical University of the Holy Cross in Rome. He is an ordinary member of the Pontifical Academy of St. Thomas Aquinas and is the author of Action and Conduct, Thomas Aquinas and the Theory of Action, and his most recent book, The Philosophy of St. Thomas Aquinas, A Sketch, was published in 2015 by Cascade Books. He has published over 40 articles in scholarly journals, such as the International Philosophical Quarterly, the Thomist, Acta Philosophica, and the Review of Metaphysics. With a CV like that, we can make him an honorary Dominican tonight, I believe. No. His lecture tonight is an exposition of Thomas's Fifth Way. So please help me in welcoming Father Stephen Brock.
Thank you very much, Father Powell, for that very kind introduction. And thank you, Father Wehner, where are you? Somewhere. Dr. Neal, and everyone for all the hospitality. I've been here a couple of days, and it's been just a pleasure to be here. And it's also a very great honor. So thank you very much. So what I mainly wish to do with you this evening is simply to read through and comment on the fifth of St. Thomas Aquinas' famous five ways. Everybody has the handout, which is just the fifth way. I think it's always good for people to have something to take home from a lecture. These, the five ways, as you know, these are his ways of proving that there is a God. All five of them, obviously, are worth careful study, but I find the fifth way especially remarkable for how it combines the two qualities that I mentioned in the title of the lecture, the simplicity and subtlety of the fifth way. So as we go through, I'll try to highlight these qualities. However, after we had already determined the title for the lecture, it struck me that really these same two qualities also serve to characterize something much bigger than just the fifth way, and that's St. Thomas himself. And since this is the Aquinas lecture, it's an Aquinas lecture, I thought I would just begin with some remarks about St. Thomas, the person, and about his thought generally, and then we can move into the fifth way. So, of course, above all else, St. Thomas is just that. He's a saint. And we know that the saints, in very different ways, all of the saints exemplify all of the virtues. And so we can be quite sure that St. Thomas displays a certain blend, anyway, of these two qualities, simplicity and subtlety. I mean that blend that our Lord points to when he exhorts us to be as wise as serpents and as simple as doves. He's talking about virtues. Maybe, in a way, the more obvious one is the simplicity of doves. To be simple as doves, what is that? It's to be without guile, to be open, to be sincere, not to be false, not hypocritical. It's what you see is what you get. And St. Thomas certainly had that quality. He hated falsehood in all its forms, and he was just as open as anyone could possibly be, I think. But being simple in this way, you know, it does not at all imply being a simpleton, that is easily fooled or gullible or naive. It's perfectly compatible with being as wise as a serpent. Of course, a serpent is nothing if not subtle. He's very subtle. To our Lord's hearers, I suppose, the word serpent would have brought to mind, what would he brought to mind? The old liar, you know, the tempter, the devil. So it's striking that our Lord says that. But you know, St. Paul says, of the devil, he says, we are not unaware of his devices. So we know those things. And you also know there's a famous story of an effort to tempt the young Thomas Aquinas. I'm sure you know the story. I'm not going to recount it now. But the point of the story is that, my point is that St. Thomas saw through the designs of the tempters right away. He was not fooled at all. He saw through it, and he reacted with amazing vigor to that temptation. And it was amazing, you know, because in a lot of ways, but partly because he was generally considered, I think we can say he was sort of considered a nerd, St. Thomas. You know, he was very silent, he was sort of abstracted, you know, very bookish. You know. But he was practical, he was very practical. He was just as practical as I think we can say Mary of Bethany, you know, Martha's sister, was practical. Mary sitting at the feet of Jesus and not budging. Just like Mary, St. Thomas knew exactly what he wanted. And he was very simple and frank about that. And he had the subtlety to know how to avoid being cheated of what he wanted. He saw through all of the devil's devices. So what did he want? What did St. Thomas want? Well, he wanted the truth. He wanted the truth. He wanted all of the truth. He wanted to see it for himself, and he also wanted to help others see it. And I think it's especially here in his thought, you know, that the terms simplicity and subtlety characterize St. Thomas. He's simple in what sense? He's simple in the sense that he always goes straight to the point. You know, there's another famous story of St. Thomas that a sister of his asked him what she needed to do in order to become a saint. And you might have expected a treatise on sanctity, you know. He answered her in one word. Vele. Want. Just want it. If you want to be, in order to become a saint, all you have to do is want it. Of course, he means really want it and do whatever it takes, therefore, to get it. So it's simple, but it's not necessarily so easy. Okay? And it's not easy to think like St. Thomas either. It's not easy to come up with the right one-word answer to a question. It's not easy to come up with the really punchy sound bite. And his thought is quite subtle. He can make very, very fine distinctions, as we'll see, I think. And he puts them so clearly that he makes them seem easy when you read them. But you realize that they're not easy when you try to put them into your own words, and you get very confused very quickly. That happens to all of us, I think. And you know, not all great thinkers have this gift of being both simple and subtle. For example, Blessed John Duns Scotus, he was called the subtle doctor. But I don't think it ever occurred to anyone to call him the simple doctor. No, he's extremely complicated and very difficult to read. And as complex minds often are, he's rather long-winded. St. Thomas is not long-winded. He did write some very big books, but he is a very model of conciseness or succinctness. He never wastes words. I don't think it's a coincidence, you know, that what seems from his writings to be his favorite example of a venial sin is the utterance of an idle word. That's his usual example. In any case, the fifth way is going to give us just a prime example of his succinctness. As you can see in the handout, it's very brief. It's also very subtle. We'll have to go through it to see the subtlety of it, but it's extremely, extremely brief. Before going into it, though, let me say one more thing in my own defense, if I can put it that way. I mean, if simplicity and succinctness are such desirable qualities, is there any excuse for my going on now about this argument for another 45 minutes or so? Thomas is so short. How can I justify being so long-winded about this? Well, I think I have a justification, I hope. Let me make another distinction between being succinct and giving a dense explanation of something. I think it's clear in teaching, being succinct is a virtue. It means that you've got a well-defined set of ideas that you want to get across. That you select the right set of words to convey it, that you don't have fillers, you don't make digressions, there aren't redundancies. You're clear. That's a virtue, obviously. But density is something else, and density may not be a virtue. It just means that the ideas are all pressed very close together, right? And that may mean that they've become indigestible. It can make the students feel dense in another sense, right? When really they're not. You know? Sometimes it's justified, I suppose. You know, if you're giving simply a very rapid presentation of something, just as a sketch, and then you're going to go over it and flesh it out, you know, like lecture notes, something like that, can be very dense in themselves. In fact, many of the writings that we have of Aristotle seem to be something like that, like lecture notes. But of course, we don't have Aristotle to flesh them out now. And they can make you feel very dense, his writings. But over the centuries, Aristotle has had some very gifted readers, some of whom have tried to make his writings less opaque, less dense for us, to spell them out by writing commentaries on them. And it's almost universally acknowledged that St. Thomas is one of Aristotle's very best commentators. So St. Thomas takes many more words usually to say what Aristotle means than Aristotle takes to say it. That's the whole point of a commentary. But no one accuses St. Thomas of being long-winded for that reason. His commentaries actually are quite succinct in a way. If you compare them with other commentaries on the same passages, you see that he's very succinct in what he has to say. Now, even St. Thomas's own works, such as the Summa Theologiae, which we're going to see, even though they're not nearly as dense as Aristotle's, they too can call for this. They can call for some commentary, some unpacking, some spelling out. There are various reasons for that, but let me just mention one that applies to the fifth way. The fifth way, it seems to me, in itself, it's not just succinct. It really is dense, very compressed. But why is that justified? It's justified because Thomas wrote the fifth way not as lecture notes, the Summa is not lecture notes, but in the five ways, really what he's doing is summing up arguments that he assumes we've already had explained to us in some detail. I say that because he assumes when you get to the Summa, when you get to theology, he assumes that those who are undertaking the study of theology have already done a complete curriculum of philosophical studies. And in his view, proving that there is a God, reasoning to the conclusion that there is a God, is more a philosophical job than a theological job. That's interesting in itself. I'm not going to explain that now. Maybe we can talk about it later. St. Thomas also assumes that Aristotle's works would figure heavily in that pre-theological curriculum, that philosophical curriculum. He assumes that. One of those works is especially important for us. It's the work called the Physics. Might be better translated natural things. But that work is very key for the fifth way. In fact, St. Thomas, in his commentary on the Physics, took the trouble to spell out in detail the essence of the fifth way. I think we find it there, spelled out in many more words, much more detail in his commentary. So that's how I justify what I'm doing, saying in many more words what I think the fifth way means than the fifth way itself needs to express itself. But I won't do just that. I'm not going to just explain what I think it means. I also want to relate it to some issues that I think are very alive today. I think that will give us an even stronger sense of how very simple and how very subtle the argument is. Of course, for Thomas, the really vital question is another one, as it should be for us, and that is whether the argument is true. But showing that it's true is pretty much the job of the argument itself. So let's look at the argument. Let's look at the fifth way. As I said, Thomas presents the five ways as ways of proving that there is a God. And that's the word he uses, proving, probandi. And he means it. Each way is supposed to offer sufficient evidence and sufficient reasoning for our really, we can say, seeing with our mind's eye the truth of this proposition that there is a God. Of course, they don't pretend to make us see God himself. That's different. They mean to make us see things in the world as God-dependent, as being in ways that would be impossible for them to be in if there were not a God. That's what the five ways want to show us. But it's also important, you know, the five ways are not meant to prove more than they say they do. Each of the ways finishes with a certain description of what it has proved, and it says that's a God. So it's proving the existence of a God as so described. He doesn't mean to prove all at once all of God's attributes. After the five ways, he enters into a long discussion, a long study of God's attributes. Right? God's simplicity, God's goodness, God's infinity, even God's unity comes later. He's not asking here whether there's exactly one God. He's not trying to prove monotheism in the five ways. He's asking, is there at least one God? Whether there might be more, he's going to take that up later on. So we shouldn't expect too much. We should expect a lot, you know, if he's trying to prove that there's a God, but not too much from the five ways. So he begins, a fifth way is gathered from the government of things. To govern, St. Thomas explains, means to direct something's activity toward a goal. So he aims to help us focus on how certain things engage in purposeful activity. and to help us see that this implies their subjection to a governor, a divine governor. That's the basic idea. Notice that I say certain things. He wants us to look at certain things. This is interesting. He's not going to ask us to lift our gaze to the whole world and see the order in the world and the government that implies. That way of arguing for God has been around for a long time, and sometimes Thomas mentions that. He says the world is like a well-ordered house, right? Someone must be in charge. But that's not exactly the argument of the fifth way. In the fifth way, he only cites a particular class of things. He says, we see that some things that lack cognition, namely natural bodies, operate for a goal. Of course, it's a large class. Right? It includes rocks and lakes and the air and plants and planets and stars. But it does leave some things out. It does not include animals, for example. Animals have cognition. They at least have sensation. And many goals that animals act for are things that they themselves perceive with their senses. Class also excludes bodies that are not natural. He's talking about natural bodies. So artificial bodies aren't included. Cars or computers. He's not interested in those here. Whether or not they have cognition, the activity of those things points pretty directly to the influence of human cognition, human intelligence, of the programmer or the designer or the user. Right? He wants us to focus on things that obviously have no such influence of human intelligence. He wants us to look at those things. So the next step is to produce evidence to show that natural bodies lacking cognition operate for goals. The evidence is a fact whose description is somewhat complex. I've split it into two parts in the handout. The first part is, always or for the most part, they operate in the same way. Now this, I think, hardly anybody would deny. It means that there is regularity in nature. Things of the same kind tend to act the same way. Rocks tend to fall, trees tend to grow, and so on. Without tendencies in things, there would be no natural science, you know. If acid were as likely to turn the litmus paper blue as red, you know, the litmus test would be no test of anything. Some tendencies sometimes fail. A seed might never sprout. But that doesn't happen for no reason. Something prevents it sprouting. A bird eats the seed. For St. Thomas, that's what's called chance. Chance is a coincidence that results in something other than what the thing that undergoes it was tending toward. He thinks there is chance. Things happen by chance. But he thinks chance itself requires tendencies. The bird eats the seed out of a tendency, that tendency called hunger. That's a kind of tendency. But he's not satisfied here in the fifth way simply to observe tendencies in things. He insists on tendencies of a very specific type. So he goes on. They operate in the same way such that they reach that which is best, whence it is plain that they arrive at the goal not by chance but out of a tendency. This is a much more controversial claim. It is certainly so today, and it was Thomas knew thinkers who would deny this as well. But he insists on it. They act for the best. Why does he insist on that? I think it's because of the conclusion that he's going to want to draw. He wants us to see the activities of things as caused by an intellect, caused by a mind. Thomas takes it as absolutely axiomatic that intellect always acts for true goals. Intellect aims at goods. That's how it acts. A tendency that's not toward a good is not fully intelligible. And it's not fully intelligent either. So if you see a friend, if you have a friend who's going off in what you think is a bad direction, you might very well say to him, well, don't be stupid. You're not acting intelligently. Intelligence as such makes us act well. Of course, you can act stupidly and still get a good result sometimes, right? Even if you have no idea how to shoot, you know, you might get lucky and hit the target once or twice. Okay? But if you hit the target time and time again, over and over, every day, you almost never miss, well, then nobody's going to say that it's luck. Right? And even if you fail with a certain frequency, you know, because of bad conditions or because your skill isn't so great, you know, if in every case you've come as close as could be expected to hitting the target, given your ability and all, then it's clear that you're at least aiming at the target. You really are trying to hit the target. And no one would deny that. You're not acting aimlessly. So this is what St. Thomas is saying about natural things, that how they usually act or how they tend to act yields the result which is best. That is, the result which is as good as is in their power, right? So that means they really are tending toward the good and not getting it just by luck. Of course, at this point, we have to ask, what is this good that St. Thomas is talking about? It's certainly not our good, human good. The elements are not always kind to us. I think you folks here in this part of the country, you know that better than anyone, I think. And St. Thomas knew it too. Is he talking about the good of the world as a whole? Well, he does think that things ultimately tend toward the good of the world as a whole, but that's not what he's talking about here either. In the commentary on the physics, he's very clear. He says, every natural thing tends toward what is good and best for the thing itself, according to its kind. It tends toward the fullness of being that is suited to its species or its kind. That's what he's talking about. What is that? What is that good? He gives examples in the physics that indicate that chiefly it just means the conservation in being of the kind. It's conservation in being, and also the conservation in its own activity, the activity that it tends to produce, right? Kinds tend to act a certain way. So there's kind of a circle there. And it's kind of self-promoting. The species of things are self-promoting in what they are and how they act. And they go on that way, and they tend to do so. So he gives some examples. He says, you know, animal teeth normally get positioned so as to best chew up the food. That's the normal thing, right? Feet usually grow in the best way for walking. Plant roots grow so as to favor nourishment. Fruits protect seeds and aid in their dispersal. Of course, seeds directly serve the renewal of the kind, and so on. But you know, he's not only talking about living bodies. He's talking about all natural bodies, even inanimate ones. But he says even the cycle of the seasons, the cycle of the elements, the hot and cold, wet and dry things, you know, that make up the weather, that's a cycle that kind of is self-preserving and self-maintaining. And so even there, even the elements tend to preserve themselves. So the idea is very simple, really. Natural beings come in various kinds, and there is no kind that does not tend to stay in being by its activity. No kind of thing simply gives up existence without a struggle. It's good for things to be. That's their good, to be. And they themselves do their best to go on being. Of course, best implies a comparison. We must be thinking of their doing, maybe they could do something else. And sometimes things do act in ways other than they tend to act, again, by chance or by some influence, some conditions. But what we observe is that their unusual, their abnormal ways of acting are usually worse. As Thomas says, if a foot gets out of its natural position, it does not serve for walking. It's obvious. How things usually act is usually better for them than any unusual way in which they can ever be observed to act. So that's what I think he means by things tending toward goals. Is it a valid claim? Well, I want to put that off for a moment. I'll come back to the question. But let me go through the rest of the argument first. The next step is this. Now, those things that do not have cognition do not tend toward a goal unless they are directed by something with cognition and intellect, as the arrow by the archer. I think the example is clear. It may be a bit misleading, but I'll talk about that a little later. But what we should notice, I think, is how unconditionally St. Thomas speaks. He doesn't qualify the claim in any way. Things need cognition and intellect to tend toward goals. He just gives us that example of the arrow. I think he thinks this is so obvious it doesn't need much explanation. You know? But it may not be so obvious to us, and I think he does give us help to spell it out, to explain it a little more. So I'll try to do that. Notice, first of all, the terms that he uses. He speaks of cognition and intellect. They're not synonymous. Sensation is a kind of cognition, and it differs from intellect. There's two different kinds of cognition. So let's focus first on sensation. He's saying to have a tendency toward a goal, you at least need sensation, some kind of cognition. Then we can look at that, and then we'll talk about intellect and how it differs from sensation. Let's stay with the example of the arrow. An archer shoots the arrow toward a target. What's the goal? Well, the goal is either the target or hitting the target. You can speak either way. Thomas will let you say either one. They're both the same goal, really. Hitting the target. But he's saying that in either case, there has to be cognition for that tendency to exist. Suppose we say the goal is the target. Well, it's very simple. The arrow is here, the archer is here, the target is over there. Right? The target is not in the archer, it's not in the arrow, and yet in the archer and in the arrow is a tendency toward the target. The arrow is pointed toward the target by the archer. Right? So there's something in the archer and in the arrow that's totally bound up with the target. It's kind of a function of the target, but the target isn't there. How is that? Right? It's very strange. Of course, we don't find it strange because it's obvious what the answer is. The archer sees the target. He sees the target, and so he can direct the arrow toward the target. Right? But what does that mean? It means that the target, which is over there, has a certain presence in him, in his sight. Right? And that's how he can direct the arrow toward it. That's cognition. If we think of hitting the target as the goal, it's even clearer. Right? Because the target is over there. It really exists. But hitting the target doesn't even exist yet. He's tending, the arrow is tending to hit the target, but until the archer has shot the arrow, there is no such thing as hitting the target yet. It's tending towards something that doesn't even exist. Something which does not exist is influencing the thing, influencing the arrow, giving it that tendency. How is that possible? Well, it's possible because the archer has imagined hitting the target. He's got that in mind. That's his goal. So again, a future thing, which doesn't really exist, has a certain presence here in the archer and then in the arrow, through the archer's cognition. That's how it works. Now, we're still talking about sensation. You know, even imagination for St. Thomas is a kind of sensation. It's an internal sense, he calls it. Right? It's not intellect. Intellect is something else. Many other animals have imagination. You know, if a dog is chasing a rabbit, well, you can be sure the dog is imagining something like eating the rabbit. He's got that in his mind, so to speak. Right? But in the fifth way, Thomas is saying we have to have intellect too. Why is that? I think we can give two reasons for that. A general one and a more particular one. The general one is that if we have a tendency to a goal, things really tending to the goal, that depends not only on the goal that you either sense or imagine, but it also depends on the thing that tends toward the goal. There has to be a certain proportion, a certain fit between the thing and the goal for the thing to tend toward it. Right? In other words, the archer, he not only has to aim at the target, he has to aim the right thing at the target, something that he can really shoot and make it hit the target. So he doesn't just grab anything at random and shoot it at the target. He doesn't grab a rabbit or a cheesecake, right, and shoot at the target. He grabs an arrow. An arrow is the sort of thing that can be shot toward a target, and you can hope to hit the target. Right? So there's a proportion there. And of course, arrows don't just appear out of the blue either. Someone had to think of an arrow, think of something that could move that way and make it. So there's a lot of comparing going on between the thing that is supposed to tend toward the end and the end, the goal. And quite generally, you know, comparing things, seeing proportions between things, reckoning, reasoning about things. You know, the Latin word for reason is ratio, ratio. It just means, in English, it just means a proportion. That's what it means. Right? That's intellect. Only intellect does that. The senses don't make comparisons. The other animals don't make comparisons like that. Another point has to do with what I talked about before, that the goal here, the goal we're talking about with natural things, is primarily the being of their kinds. If you're going to order toward a goal, you have to grasp it, you have to see the target. Well, here, the target is the being of a certain kind of thing. Right? St. Thomas insists, being is grasped only by the intellect, as an intellectual thing. The being of a certain kind, I mean. So you can see, for example, you can see a cow, you can imagine a cow, right? But how do you know that what you're seeing and what you're imagining is a cow? Well, you know it because you know what a cow is. You know what it is. You have some idea, maybe very imperfect, but you have some idea of what it is to be a cow. You have a definition of cow. Sight and imagination don't produce definitions. Only intellect does that. You and I know that Bessie is a cow. Bessie does not know that. She does not know that she's a cow. I don't know in Louisiana if you have Bessie the cow. I don't know. But anyway, you can change the name. But the point is, even so, cows don't know what cows are, but they go on producing cows. They do it quite well, you know. They produce things that fit the definition of a cow. Right? And they keep on doing that. Right? And he's saying that kind of tendency has to originate in something that does know what a cow is. Right? That means it must have intellect. So, the fact that natural things have genuine tendencies toward good goals is supposed to show that they are under the control of an intellect. A tree does not put its leaves into the ground and its roots into the air. That would be stupid. But there's another interesting distinction here, a very subtle distinction. Here's a piece of subtlety. The idea is that a tree acts intelligently, even though it has no intellect. How can we see that? How can we see at the same time that it's acting intelligently, but it has no intellect? It's acting always, or for the most part, in the same way, so as to reach what is best, shows that it's acting intelligently, we said. What shows that it doesn't have intellect? I think it's the same thing. That it always acts in the same way. For it will act the same way even in circumstances in which acting that way will do it no good. It will keep acting the same way. So if you take a palm tree and you plant it in Alaska, it's still going to try to grow, for a while, not very long, the way a palm tree in the tropics will grow. It won't look for ways to stay warm. Right? It can't adjust to the circumstances. The same is true of a camel. It won't build an igloo, in Alaska. It'll just try to act the way a camel does in its natural environment. They always act in the same way. They don't really understand why they're acting that way. And so when they get out of their natural habitat, they can't function, they can't adjust. Intellect can at least try to adjust. We can do that. We can build igloos or tents or whatever, depending on the circumstances. So Thomas concludes, therefore there is something intelligent by which all natural things are ordered to a goal. And this we call a God. If we have accepted the steps up to here, can we quarrel with the conclusion? If we acknowledge a mind governing everything in the physical world, is there any objection to calling it a God? Well, maybe there is. Maybe there is. Let me raise a doubt about the conclusion. Then I'm going to come back and look at some issues in the earlier steps. But this first one will help us with those. The question is the fifth way, even if it's valid, is it really giving us something fit to be called a God? Thomas himself tells us that the very word God, part of its meaning is it must be something that's very different from everything else. Anything that is qualified to be called a god has to be pretty special, pretty unique, in a class by itself. But how different is this God from things that are not so unusual for us, that is, from human beings, or at least from the human mind? It could just sound as though this God is simply the human mind writ large, so to speak. It's a mind that is lucky enough or smart enough even to control natural things. We're not quite that lucky, we can't do that, but it's basically the same kind of thing. Okay? Just a more powerful mind, or a mind that's in a lucky position. It could sound that way. We rule over a few things, we rule over cars and robots. God rules over the rest of the world. Same kind of thing. In other words, it sounds rather like the famous line by the poet Joyce Kilmer, poems are made by fools like me, but only God can make a tree. Okay. Poets make poems, engineers make robots, professors make lectures, God makes trees. and a lot of other things. But does the mere fact that someone can make trees and we cannot mean that we should call that person a god? Well, I'm not so sure, you know. I cannot make poems either. I've tried. I cannot do it. It's terrible, right? Should I therefore treat poets as gods? Professors, you know, students probably should treat their professors as gods, you know, but that's not because they can make lectures. It's for another reason, you know, so that's beside the point. So that's an objection, you know. But it rests on a misunderstanding. The idea is not that we can't make trees, but God can. That's not quite the idea. For one thing, Thomas is not saying that only God can make trees. He's not saying that. Other things can too. Trees can. Trees make trees. They do it all the time. Cows make cows, dogs make dogs, people make people. It's called reproduction. It's no mystery. Aristotle says that reproduction is the most natural activity of all, and St. Thomas agrees with him. And I think the real point of the fifth way is right here. Let me try to explain. Trees don't know what a tree is. But they make trees. They make themselves go on being trees. How? By the fact that all the parts of a tree tend toward their going on being trees. The parts tend to be in the tree. They tend to stay together in the tree. They tend to function in a way that favors the being of the tree. This is the tendency toward the conservation in being of the kind we talked about. To have a nature is to have that kind of a tendency. It goes all the way through the thing and tends to keep it in being, keep its kind in being. Poems do not make poems. And lectures do not make lectures. They may seem to go on and on and on, right? But they don't make themselves. Maybe there could be a robot that is programmed to make other robots. That's possible, I suppose. We can imitate God a little bit. But even there, the parts of a robot do not have a tendency to be in a robot. They're not by nature robot parts. Right? They don't share in robot nature. There's no such thing as robot nature in this sense. There's just metal and glass or whatever, rubber. And here I think, this is why I said before that the arrow example can be a little bit misleading. Thomas explains, when we give a tendency to a thing, as in shooting the arrow, the tendency is only sort of imposed upon the thing, forced on the thing. Right? It's not stable in the thing and doesn't penetrate all the thing's parts. We can't give things natural tendencies in that sense. Right? Tendencies that really take root in the thing, that are integrated into the thing's very identity. Factors in what it is to be that kind of thing. We can't do that. But such tendencies exist. And so the fifth way is saying there has to be a kind of mind that can do that. It's not just a question, he can make a lot of things we can't. He can put tendencies in things in a way that we have no idea even how that works, what that means. It's a very different kind of mind. The tendencies of things are their ways of producing or causing certain results. So to say that there is a mind that causes natural tendencies is to say that there is a mind that causes natural things to cause what they cause. So it's not that only God can make trees, it is that trees make trees and that only God can make them do so. It's the fundamental idea is one that the medieval thinkers expressed in very lapidary Latin. They said, opus naturae est opus intelligentiae. A work of nature is a work of intelligence. That sounds like a very simple idea. Here we have a simple idea, but it's also very subtle because it navigates between two extremes, which I think it's easy to fall into. It's easy even for Christians, maybe, to fall into one extreme or the other. One extreme is to say that what is apparently caused by natural things is really caused by God. But God does everything. Things are totally passive, and God is the only real agent. And you know, Christians have been accused of holding this view. Right? Martin Heidegger says that the Christian idea of creation has pretty much stifled the ancient experience of nature. Right? That instead of nature, which Heidegger sort of understood, it's this spontaneous, inner, self-promoting source in things, right? He thinks that Christians only see kind of divine technology working on stuff, right? The way we do. God plying his craft the way we ply ours, imposing his aims on things, not letting them be themselves, not letting them act as they are. Heidegger thinks that the Christian God is just the human mind writ large. That's what he thinks. But about that very point, St. Thomas has a remark in his commentary on the physics. He says, just this, he says, unlike human craftsmen, God can put his craft into the things that are made by it, into the things themselves. He says, it's as if a shipbuilder could put the art of building a ship into the wood. In that case, there would be such a thing as the nature of a ship. If we could give the ship, give the wood the tendency to be a ship, we could speak about the nature of a ship. In short, God's craft, his technology, doesn't obliterate the natures of things. For St. Thomas, it's the very source of the natures of things. He's seeing the natures of things and seeing God as the cause of that. That's why they tend toward the best, right? A work of nature is a work of intelligence. It's not substituted by intelligence, nature. It's work, nature's causality is caused by intelligence. The other extreme is not that God's causality substitutes nature, it's that it merely kind of completes nature, finishes nature's work, merely picks up where nature leaves off. The idea would be that nature provides the materials and then God kind of produces the finished product. And that again would be God working on things more or less the way we do. Right? And that view has been around. You know, there's a famous old argument for God's existence that said the world is like a big watch. So you have the materials of the watch, right? The metal and the glass and all. But it's so finely tuned and so well ordered that you also need a watchmaker. The materials don't explain why they are together as a watch. The mindless things of nature provide the materials, and then you have intelligence coordinating them, putting them together. That's not the argument here. Thomas thinks, on the one hand, he thinks he's very happy to acknowledge nature's that produce great complexity. The soul of a living thing, the animating principle of a living thing, is a principle of great complexity. The organism is very complex, and he knows that. And the principle of that is in the thing. It's its nature. God is the cause of that nature, but the nature itself is the cause of the complexity. And he also thinks that we have to see God even as the cause of the natures of the simplest, crudest kinds of things, the simplest materials. Again, nature, any work of nature is also a work of intelligence. That's the idea. Before I close, let me say just something about what I think would be the most likely source of objections to the fifth way. I think it would be the theory of evolution, wouldn't it? Is the fifth way compatible with evolution? One reason for suspecting that it's not is simply all the evidence for the fact that some species of living things have gone extinct. The crucial thesis, as I argued for in the fifth way, is that things tend to go on existing, to conserve themselves in their species. Kinds of things go extinct. You know, that's what's worst for the species, not what's best. So that's an objection. How can we answer that? I think the answer is very simple. It's true, extinction is the worst thing for a species, but the fact that a species goes extinct does not prove that the species wasn't tending to do the best it can to survive. Doing better than any other way of acting that species is capable of would do. Only even the best was not good enough, that's all. That doesn't prove that there wasn't really that tendency. Thomas is only interested in that tendency. It's an intelligent tendency, even if it fails. Even if it fails. God doesn't have to put all of his wisdom into every single kind of thing. He puts a certain wisdom, and it may fail. That's all right. God has reasons of his own, for his purposes, of making things like that. But they have a certain spark of the divine wisdom in them. You'd have an objection only if it turned out that some kinds of things do not truly do the best they can to survive. They have the resources and they don't use them. Then you would have an objection, right? Or if they went directly against their own well-being. Maybe you remember an old Far Side cartoon that has the dinosaurs, the real reason why the dinosaurs went extinct is that they smoked. Right? That would be a problem for the fifth way. That would be a problem for the fifth way. But it's a joke. Right? It's not true. Another objection that you might get from evolution is that the way in which new kinds are said to come into being is largely a matter of chance, random mutations, genetic mutations. Most mutations produce bad results, monstrous results, but once in a while something better comes along, an improvement. The theory grants that once the new species are up and running, you know, the better adapted kinds, they keep on going just because of what they are, right? But the origin of the species is not any tendency. There's no tendency toward the new species. It's just a matter of chance. I think this can be answered too, though. Thomas is not denying the existence of chance at all. I said that before. He's not, and he will not accept the idea that God doesn't have control over chance. He thinks God does control chance. That's an interesting idea. Maybe we can talk about that later. Even chance falls under God's providence. But here he's just not interested in what happens by chance. He's not talking about things that happen by chance. All sorts of things can happen by chance. And he's saying nothing at all about whether or not the kinds of things that there are now have always been here, or how they came into being, even whether they came into being by chance. He's only saying that the kinds that are there, when they're there, they tend toward their own conservation. If by chance their activity gives rise to something new, something that they don't tend toward, and a new and a better kind of thing, that's not relevant. It's very interesting, but it's not even relevant to what he's talking about. The fifth way is not talking about how things are got up and running. It's only interested in how they run, once they're up and running. There would only be a problem if we found out that the kinds don't do the best they can. That is, if they don't really struggle to survive. That would be the problem. But of course, that would be a problem for the theory of evolution, too, wouldn't it? If things don't really struggle to survive. The theory of evolution absolutely assumes that. Right? So it seems to me that the theory of evolution is not only compatible with the fifth way, in a sense, it confirms it. Because insofar as it insists that things struggle to survive, insists on the very tendency toward the conservation in being that Thomas is talking about. Evolution takes that tendency for granted. Thomas is inviting us to wonder about that tendency, to marvel at that tendency, and to ask how can that tendency possibly exist, and how can it be so very widespread? And that's the last difference, that's the last point I want to mention. That tendency for Thomas is even more widespread than evolutionary theory makes it. For evolution only talks about living things. Thomas sees the tendency toward being in all things. He has the most universal outlook, right? And therefore the simpler outlook. All of reality is like that, all natural things. In a sense, it's the most universal outlook of all, the being of things. Nothing is more universal than being. And no tendency is more universal than the tendency toward being. Right? And it's the most intelligible tendency, I think we can say, the one we most easily understand. It's the one that it's obvious that things should tend that way, tend toward their being. Right? So that's intellect. The power of understanding, intellect, can generate a lot of complexity, it can make a lot of distinctions, but what it is, first of all, is just that. It's the power to engage with the being of things as such. And we all do that. We all do that. And yet, as we interact with the things, you know, it takes a metaphysician, doesn't it? It takes a metaphysician like St. Thomas to keep the being of things in view. Focus on that. And I don't know whether we should say that that's because he is so subtle or because he is so simple. Thank you.
Thank you, Father Brock. We're going to take a short 5-minute break, and we'll come back. We'll have about 30 minutes of question time. So we'll be back in 5 minutes. Okay, if we could begin to come back together, please. To start our question and answer section now. We just have a couple of guidelines we'd like for you to follow. One of those is please only ask questions, refrain from making comments, simply ask a question, and ask only one question, if you would, okay? If you have a follow-up question, just make sure that it's on the same issue, okay, rather than an entirely different question, because that would be two questions, and that's against the rules. So, we're also going to ask that you model your questions on St. Thomas, that is, that they be have a certain quality of simplicity about them and subtlety, but also keep it short, okay? All right, so we're going to, Father, if you want to come to the podium. No. No. My answer is always, Thomas is right, end of story.
That's not a bad answer.
Oh, one other thing, I'm sorry. If you would, Dr. Neal reminded me, please make sure that you ask her questions, you articulate, you enunciate, like your homiletics professor tells you to do. You enunciate so that everybody can hear you. Okay? Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
evening, Father. I'm Doug Bush. I'm a second theologian here, one of the older theologians here. Anyway, I was real interested in your this chance, your discussion about Thomas believed in chance, and that chance falls under God's providence. Could you, is chance and luck synonymous, and where does randomness fit in to all of that?
Okay, I can answer the first part. I'm not sure about randomness, but no, Thomas kind of follows Aristotle on this. He makes a distinction between chance and luck. I think chance is a broader concept. It's just what I said. It's what happens outside the tendency of a thing, right? Just by a coincidence, things affect each other, and so the result is something that neither of them was tending toward, right? And it could be good, it could be bad, it could be indifferent, right? So, you know, two cars collide, right? Neither of them is tending toward the collision, but they happen to be in the same place. One is going that way, and the other is going, and they stop in the middle. They weren't tending to stop in the middle, but that's what happens, right? Luck is, when you speak about luck, he thinks you're looking at it in terms of good and evil, right? So a lucky result is one that you would have aimed at if you had foreseen it. You would have gone there because it was, and so you call it lucky. I went to the store and I found my friend there. I didn't know he was there, but if I had known, I certainly would have gone because I wanted to see him. So that's good luck. Bad luck is the opposite, what you would have avoided, right? So luck is a little bit narrower, right, I think, than chance. Now, randomness is kind of a concept in scientific thought, which I'm not sure I want to get into, but you maybe you should answer that. Because I'm not sure but even random things have sources. The point is that chance can't be a first principle. That's the main point here. Chance presupposes tendencies in things. If the cars weren't tending in any direction, they wouldn't collide either, right? And so even when you have something that produces random numbers, it has a certain kind of functioning, and it tends to function in the way it does. And the result is that the numbers come out at random. It could be any number, but that's because of the kind of tendencies that have been put into the thing so that it will produce those numbers in that way. Does that make sense?
Sure.
All right.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
So one of the points that you proposed was whenever you put a palm tree in the Arctic, it'll show that by the way it grows, it'll do the same thing and die, showing that it doesn't have mind. But I mean, we see over evolution that there are some species that sort of adapt. Does that show some sort of intrinsic mind to the thing?
Good question. Yeah, thank you. Here, I think it's really important to make a distinction, or not to blur a distinction, which I think happens sometimes in discussions of evolution, which is the distinction between the behavior of an individual of the kind and the behavior over time of the kind itself, right? So I was talking about an individual palm tree, right? It's not going to come up with a way to survive in the Arctic. It's not even going to look for a way, so to speak. It can't look for anything. Over time, maybe if it got lucky enough to stick it out, maybe it would change. You know, the future generations would be more adapted to those new circumstances. That's right. And that's a totally different point, right? How whether or not that shows intelligence, I think the idea behind most evolutionary theory is that we can explain that without any appeal to intelligence. Any direct appeal to intelligence. From the point of view of the fifth way, I think that's an open question. It doesn't really matter. Maybe you can explain it by an appeal to intelligence. Maybe you can explain it just by random mutations and the fit things survive and the unfit things don't, right? God will still be, from Thomas's point of view, God will still be in charge of that, even if it's down here, it's by chance, right? He'll still be in charge of it. So from the point of view of the fifth way, it doesn't really matter. He's talking about how the individuals of a kind behave, and they always behave, of that kind, always behave in a determinate way. Even if future generations will behave differently. That's not this one. It's not going to change its behavior. An intellectual being can change his own. An individual can change his way of behaving. If we go from the tropics to the Arctic, we're going to change clothes, you know, and things like that. Does that answer the question?
Follow-up would be, does it change species in order to change like that?
That's over my head.
Okay.
Thank you. The whole how to distinguish species and whether there are species, I'm not going to get it. I don't know how to deal with that. I could say some dumb things about it, but I'm not even going to go there. It's a really fundamental question, I think, but I'm just not confident.
Oh. Martin Heber, Thought Theology. You mentioned Martin Heidegger. I want to mention one of his friends called Friedrich Nietzsche.
Nietzsche, okay.
Yeah. Nietzsche says God is dead. So which God is he making reference to? Is it the Judeo-Christian God or the God of human intelligence like we can get arrived with this fifth way?
Well, that's a good question. I'm not sure how. It's not really. You do modern philosophy. I did. You know, Nietzsche says, speaking about evolution. I'm just avoiding the question by saying this, but speaking about evolution, Nietzsche calls evolution the theory of the greatest possible stupidity of nature. That's how he defines evolution. That's how he understood Darwinism. The theory of the greatest possible stupidity of nature. He didn't like the theory of evolution at all, Nietzsche. I think that's kind of interesting. Right? He thought it was kind of a pathetic view of things. Right? That may be partly because Darwin was an Englishman, but that's another issue. I don't think Nietzsche really ever got the idea of the Christian God or the Catholic God. You know, God is dead. He thinks of God pretty much in terms of morality. And the slave morality of Christianity and the kind of Platonism for the masses. You know, God is just another world where we project certain things. So he never really got very far in his understanding of the true understanding of the Christian God. What he's basically saying is we've gotten beyond morality. That's what he's interested in. And we're free now to live full human lives, because we don't have the constraints of this slavish kind of morality anymore. So that's about all I can say about Nietzsche, I think. Okay?
Deacon Ryan Hoffer from Fourth Theology. And I had a question in terms of, we're switching between humans who have intellects, natural bodies, without intelligence, but have some type of organic life, and then these, you know, non-organic natural bodies, the rest of creation. It seemed like a lot of the argument and distinctions rested on these natural organic bodies, the fact that their parts are ordered towards the whole, and that this tendency of the part being ordered towards the whole indicates a nature. And that if we can prove that things have natures, then Aquinas' argument seems to work out really well. What's confusing to me is that some of the examples he uses seem to be misleading, especially in light of evolution, because the feet, in terms of being convenient to walking, those could be explained in other ways, as well as the teeth in regards to eating. But it seems that if we're going to apply this to non-organic things in terms of having natures, where do we prove that the parts are ordered towards the whole the same way that we see in organic things? So yeah, each one of my parts of my body is ordered towards the unity of my whole. It has a certain intrinsic unity.
Yeah.
But if other things have extrinsic unity, or I guess another way of phrasing is, can this fifth way work without even reference to the natures of organic things and use it purely in reference to non-organic
bodies?
Oh, I
see, okay. Yeah, okay. That's about five questions, I think. No, it's all right. It's all right. About feet, let me say something about feet, first of all. again, I think it's really important to distinguish the question about the kind from the question of the individual. I think evolution theory would completely agree that the reason why those feet, your feet, are there is because that's more conducive to survival. Right? Because our kind is a kind that's well adapted, right? Partly because of the way our feet grow. So the reason why your feet are there, even for evolutionary theory. Another question is why there is any such thing as feet, or why humans have feet, or something like that, in the general question, right? But Thomas is not worried about the general question. He's worried about the individual question. And I think on that, he and evolution theory agree, right? And there is a kind of teleology within evolution, within the species, once the species is up and running. There is the struggle to survive, and that's shown in the case of things that have feet. It's shown in the way their feet grow. That's part of the struggle to survive, and that exists for evolution. So I don't think that's a problem. But that's a very good question about the parts of inorganic things, which is a lot more complicated for us than it would have been for St. Thomas, you know, because his idea is that, for example, water is a very, very uniform sort of thing, right? It's water all the way down. It's just very uniform. Molecules and atoms and all that. So it's water all the way down. So it's very easy to see that the parts are ordered to the whole because it's all exactly the same stuff. You know, the qualities are all the same and all, right? What we need to see, but you see this in both in organic things and in inorganic things. We just had a conference about this in my university. You know, that the parts of a molecule, we can say that the simplest component of an inorganic thing is a molecule, the stable component of an inorganic kind, right? The parts function differently in the molecule than they do outside the molecule. Take water, right? Hydrogen and oxygen, they have certain properties, certain ways of functioning on their own. You produce when they come together? Well, you produce water. You know, you have and the compound. Now, the ions, and so they don't function at all the way hydrogen and oxygen did. They don't function at all the same. Now they're different. Now they're parts of water, right? And their own spontaneous way of tending to act is different when they are in a water molecule. You can split the molecule again and produce oxygen by electrolysis, right? And then they'll act. But Aristotle knew that. You can take. There's a kind of a cycle, but they really function differently, and that shows that water really is a natural thing. Right? In the water, the parts have the nature of water. They're tending toward the unit, which is the water molecule. See what I mean? So I think it's a very good. It's a fundamental question, but I think the answer is. Seems to be quite positive. Yeah.
Thank you, Father, for your considerations tonight. If Aquinas is correct that natural tendency is evidence of God, could you comment on how it is, at least in Revelation, that when God manifests himself, it's by going against these natural tendencies? The burning bush is not consumed, water becomes wine, etc. Thank you.
That's a good question. I hadn't thought of that. It's coming from left field, sort of, you know. Well, isn't the first way in which God manifests himself creation? And if you look at chapter 1 of Genesis, it's all about nature, it seems to me. Sometimes people say that there's no concept of nature in the Bible. I don't understand that. Each thing according to its kind, be fruitful and multiply, according to its kind. He repeats that over and over again, and he saw that it was good, right? It's nature, he's making natures, right? Kinds that have, that generate themselves, that promote themselves, right? And that's where God first shows himself, isn't it, right? We're stupid, and he has to go beyond that sometimes and say, hey, look, wake us up, you know? St. Thomas has a really interesting remark about Adam and Eve. You know, he didn't think that Adam and Eve could see God. He because if they could see God, they would never have sinned, okay? But he thought that their minds were not darkened the way ours are before sin. Their minds were not darkened, and just looking at the world, they would not even have had to do any reasoning, like we've been doing in the fifth week. They would have immediately grasped that there is a God behind this. It would have been so obvious to them. So he's manifesting himself all the time, like right now here, but we're just too dull to see it. And so he has to take these sort of unnatural, so to speak, the miraculous ways in order to get our attention. But I think that's down the road, and that's kind of on the assumption of sin and all the rest. Does that make sense? Okay.
My name is Matthew Hoffpower, and I'm in First Theology this year. It's kind of funny. I took kind of an opposite. My question was almost an opposite angle from Deacon Ryan Halford's. My question was, is the inclusion of living organisms in this argument, is it superfluous at best, or at worst has a kind of circularity in it that makes it not even a good argument? And what I mean by that is, I think you would have to go down to the level of inorganic matter and the nature of inorganic things to make the argument based on, I mean, if you think about the concept of, again, bringing evolution into this, I guess, if you have, you could have animals, I guess this is zeroing in on, again, that's they operate such that they reach that which is best. I mean, you could have animals that came into being for whatever reason that, like, or very, very early forms of life, I guess, that do not tend towards conservation of their being, but then we would only have the ones that have toward conservation of their being still in existence now, because the other ones wouldn't last very long, like a bacteria that never ate because it never got hungry. It wouldn't, it would last for a few minutes.
Yeah, right. Whereas it's clear in inorganic, you don't have failures in the inorganic world. Is that what
you're saying? Yeah, because you could argue, I guess I'm saying that there's a certain, you could say the fact that trees and plants exist and keep themselves in being, they tend toward preservation of their own being.
Yeah.
That doesn't prove anything because
there were a bunch of others that didn't do that, but they're not there anymore because they didn't do that.
Yeah, basically.
Okay, yeah, good, okay. That's a good question. Let me say two things. One is, I think it's important for Thomas that everything is like this, right? That it's not just a certain zone of reality where you have the tendency toward what is best, that it's organic things, inorganic things, and ultimately animals and human beings too, right? We do a lot of, we're the one species that can directly act against the good of our own nature, but even in us, that's not easy to do, right? It takes work, right? It takes effort to do things that go against your nature, right? Especially your own life, right? Nobody does that without a lot of reluctance anyway. But it's important because he wants to see that this is really a tendency in things and not just something that happens to some of them, that some of them have that tendency and some of them don't. If it's in all things, because he concludes the argument, God governs all things, right? And he has to see, so he needs that. But with regard to organic things, I think the point is the same as that we've been making all along. Right? He's perfectly aware that monstrosities arise, right, in the world of organic existence. Sometimes the offspring is not viable, right? Sometimes the offspring is not viable and doesn't tend toward its own survival or the survival of the kind. And so it doesn't survive, and so you don't get a species that's like that. That's right. But the point is simply there are things that have these tendencies, and these tendencies are really there. Once we grant that the tendency is really there, right? Whether or not, you know, occasionally something without that tendency pops up, again by chance, is not relevant. The tendency itself couldn't be there. Ontologically, it's without an intelligence, for the reason I gave before. It's the very idea of a tendency is it's being a function of something that doesn't exist yet, a future thing, right? And in this case, it's being a function of the being of the thing, which is a purely intelligible item, right? So if once you grant the tendency in things, he's won. He's won the game, it seems to me, right? Does that make sense? Okay.
So my name is Tim Grimes. I'm in third theology. It's very obvious how living things struggle to survive. But how does something like a rock,
struggle
even planet
to survive?
Earth, how does that struggle to survive?
Because yeah,
it seems
question.
Like that was kind of foundational and fundamental to the fifth way.
Okay, good. You ever try to destroy a rock? It's not easy. Rocks resist being destroyed. They're really hard to destroy, right? They don't just sort of give up, right? They last a long time. There's, you know, in Rome, there's a lot of rocks. They've been there a long time, you know, and they're exactly the way they were 2,000 years ago, right? They don't need to reproduce. They're, you know, the individuals, they just keep going, right? We need to reproduce. Organisms need to reproduce because the organism being made up of all kinds of different parts, the parts wear each other out. And so our very nature is such that we die, right? Rocks don't have that problem. So they don't need to reproduce. The individual can just go on, keep itself. But it's still tending to go on. And it's going to keep going on. And something really, really powerful comes and smashes it or blows it up or whatever, dissolves it. Right? So I think that a rock is a great example of what he's talking about. Okay.
Father, looking at like a pastoral application of what you have given us tonight about Thomas making this argument that it's in the creation of the nature of things that we can come to know of a creator, it just kept coming to my mind that we live in a culture that really rejects the nature of things on a ton of levels. And so I was just wondering in your experience, maybe even pastorally as a priest, in the academic sphere and also in the everyday sphere of talking to people, is there like a way in which you've engaged this topic? And what's a good way to engage that topic?
That's
that there are actual natures, and we need to affirm that before we can, you know, so thank
you.
Yeah,
that's a very good question. You know, one of the previous speakers here in the Aquinas Lecture, Father Duan, who I think was really a master of metaphysics. I learned more from him than from anyone. He was very fond of quoting a letter from Etienne Gilson, the great Thomas scholar, to another great Thomas, Jacques Maritain. And Gilson said to Maritain, you know what separates us from our contemporaries, meaning contemporary philosophers, right, is one concept. And it's not, as you might have expected from Gilson, if you know Gilson, it's not the concept of being, right? And it's not truth even though relativism and all was already quite rampant. He said it's the concept of nature. We've lost the concept of nature, and we have to get it back, right? And I think that's quite right. So I think you're absolutely right. It's really fundamental. How to do it pastorally? Well, you know, my work as teacher, so I just make the students read Thomas Aquinas, you know, that's kind of what they just have to read it over and over again until they get the idea, right? But no, seriously, I think we are kind of alienated from nature, you know? What does God do with Adam? He puts him in the garden, and then he takes him to the zoo, right? He shows him the animals, right? He gives him the experience. We have to have the direct experience of the natural world, I think. You know, in Chicago, they bus kids from the inner city. They bus them out to the country so they can see a cow. You know, they've never seen cows. It's unbelievable. You know, know, it's terrible. You know, I think there's no substitute for just being in the natural world, right? And just letting, because I think the human heart just sort of naturally responds to that, right? Doesn't it? And it's just amazing. Nate, you know, you see that, I know, and there's all kinds of resources now. You know, there's all kinds of documentaries about animals and plants, and they're wonderful, and you just see how incredible the natural world is. I think people should be much more exposed to that. That's all. I don't know. I don't have a plan for that, but I think it would be really important to promote that, yeah.
Joe will be our last question.
Thank you, Father. Joe Bass, Second Theology.
Then I'd like to add one thing after.
TJ's a lot smarter than me, so in your face, TJ. So taking a similar angle that Nick did, what would Aquinas have to say to a philosopher like Hume or Simone de Beauvoir or Jean-Paul Sartre, who, especially with Hume, there is no room for tendency of any kind
sure isn't.
In his philosophy, you know? Yeah. So this may just be another first principles question, but I'm not necessarily thinking about a pastoral application, but what's a way to even begin to dialogue with somebody who denies a first principle of tendency whatsoever? And then somebody like an existentialist who would say, sure, things are becoming, but never actually being anything.
Yeah, that's a good question. I'm not sure there's a general answer to that question. I think the more Aristotelian approach is to look at each particular one and exactly how he reasons and to find the... we are at the level of first principles. I think that's right. Right? Aristotle himself says that it's obvious that things have natures. It's obvious that there is nature. And nobody can really deny that, right? You have to be an idiot sort of to deny it, right? But of course, we get confused and we do deny things that we can't really deny. He knows of people who think they can deny the principle of non-contradiction, right? And it's mainly, as Father Duan used to say, it's mainly a question. First of all, you have to assume that you're dealing with an honest person who's not just trying to play a game with you. With Hume, that's not always clear, it seems to me. Right, because he's a bit of a sophist, right? He's got a bit of an agenda, although he's a brilliant philosopher in a lot of ways too. But if you're dealing with an honest person, then you have to just try to be as clear as you possibly can, right? In saying what you think, because often it's a question they're misunderstanding something, right? Or they're adding something to what you're saying, or they're qualifying. So just trying to be as clear as you can, to lay it out as simply as you possibly can, and to try to identify the ways in which, despite themselves, they are granting what they think they are denying. That's what Aristotle does with the principle of non-contradiction. If he gets you to even to say a word, well, you think that word doesn't mean the opposite of that word, right? And so you got to shut up entirely if you're going to be consistent, right? And then there's no point in arguing, right? I think that's how Thomas would want to deal with that, but it's not easy. Obviously, it's a constant struggle. There's no final answer that just gets them to be quiet. I think that's right. I wanted to say one other thing. It's kind of connected with the existentialists and also with Nietzsche. You know, the God is dead thing that Nietzsche. Nietzsche thinks, well, this is going to be a liberation. You know, he's always talking about life and vitality and all the rest. And I always connect that, you know, there's the sort of the Christian existentialist Dostoevsky, who says that if there's no God, you know, in the Brothers Karamazov, if there's no God, then everything is allowed, right? And Nietzsche is saying, that's right, and that's why we got to get rid of God, you know, so that, because then everything is allowed, right? It always seemed to me that for St. Thomas, in a way that's true, but in a way the opposite is true. That if there's no God, then really nothing is allowed. In the sense that if there's no God, then nothing is really quite rational to do. Because we need something that ultimately our hearts and our minds, our intellects, need something that we can give ourselves to entirely. That we can love with our whole heart. And there's nothing but God that fits the bill, right? And everything we do, Thomas says, is out of love, right? And so if there's nothing that we can rationally love with our whole heart, then there's nothing that we can rationally do. It would be better just not to be. I think that's a better answer to Nietzsche than a lot of the other ones. So that's it. That's all I want to say. Okay, thank you.
Stand and close with a prayer, please. In the name of the Father, and the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Loving and merciful God, everything we have and everything we are is a gift from you. We give you thanks and praise for all that you have given us and receive all your blessings. Father, we ask you to take us into this night to keep us safe. We ask you to bless our speaker, Father Brock, and his ministry as a teacher in Rome. We ask you to keep us always mindful of our duties to preach your good news to the whole world. And we ask all this through Christ our Lord. Amen. Amen. Go in peace. Thanks be to God.